Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Mages and Masquerades by Katerina Martinez and Tansey Morgan. Narrated by Rachel Dulude. Chapter 1. I had 10 seconds to reach the other side of the alley and take the corner, or a demon was going to kill someone. How did I know that? Because the someone was Ivy. And while she was a capable shade, sometimes their magic just didn't work to trick a demon's infernal eyes. He had seen her, and when he saw her, he had known she'd been watching him, tracking him. Maybe he'd even known how long she'd been tailing him for. Now he was following her, and I knew, as soon as he got to her, he would kill her, slicing her skin open and pulling her insides out as easily as a human draws breath. Push, Haley, push. My heart thrashed against my chest like an animal trying to pound its way out of my ribcage. My hands were pumping at my sides, my legs propelling me across the asphalt floor so fast I was almost flying, lungs burning from the massive distance I just had to cross. 3 blocks in less than 60 seconds was no joke, especially when you had to avoid people and cars, and do your best to stave off the growing feeling in your belly that you'd miscalculated, and that Ivy's body had already been pulled open at the hands of a vicious, angry demon. I counted down from 8 in my head, giving me 2 seconds to spare as I ran, at the same time drawing the business end of my knife along the top of my forearm. The sensation was cold at first, as the razor-sharp edge of the blade split a perfect seam along my skin. I winced at the sensation, doing my best not to let it slow me down. I had done this 100 times, but it never got any easier or any more pleasant. A steadily blossoming flower of pain opened, and I had to fight the sickly feeling as blood began to spill from the wound, quickly coating my arm and dripping to my hands from the motion of running. But I could feel it now, magic rushing through me and around me more freely, aided by the power of my sacrifice, of my self-inflicted injuries. I ran the side of the blade along my arm, making sure to smear as much of the blood as I could onto its face, and just as I rounded the corner, reaching the number 3 on my countdown, I saw them. The knife in my hand started to glow red as my psychic will, my invisible hand, enveloped it. Then I released it into the sky until it moved above the tops of streetlights, where their radiance couldn't touch it, where it disappeared, and where I could forget about it, at least for now. "Hey, asshole!" I yelled across the street. The demon stopped and turned to look at me. He was a smooth-looking cat in an Armani suit, Italian loafers, and was sporting a haircut that probably cost more than a month's rent where I used to live. Demons were all like that, all expensive clothes, impeccable physiques, charming facades to hide the rot inside. Demons were so damn good-looking. It was a distraction at the best of times, but warlocks had a way to see through that. Even from the distance, from all the way across the other side of the street, I could sense his incredible, cruel, deadly intelligence. This was a creature that had more brain power than 5, 10, maybe even 50 people. 5,000 IQ points of calculating, cold logic backed up by the ability to see into the near future, and a capacity for brutality that would make even the worst possible human being seem almost redeemable. Almost. Ivy was walking ahead of him, maybe 10 feet of distance between them. Her magical invisibility dropped. Vulnerable was the word that came to mind.
"What did you say to me?"
he asked, pointing at his chest and glowering at me like I'd spat all over his suede shoes. "You need me to speak up, Grandpa?"
"Grandpa? Do I look old to you, you little bitch?"
I could see Ivy continuing to walk, creating a bigger gap between the two of them, one I didn't think he would be able to cross now, not without me having ample time to intercept.
"What you look like is the most pretentious piece of shit I've ever come across."
A man in his 40s, scarf tucked up to his mouth, hair graying at the edges, passed me in the street and gave me a what-the-hell look. "It's cool, he's a friend," I said. Maybe he muttered something about Americans as he walked off, or maybe he didn't say anything at all. I wasn't sure. My heart was beating too fast, running away with me. "Now you listen here," the demon said, pointing at me and walking across the street. "I don't know who the fuck you think you are to think you could talk to me like that, but yeah, whatever. Look, the woman you're following is obviously not interested, so how about you pack it in and go somewhere else?" His cheeks were burning bright red, but don't let that fool you. This thing in front of me wasn't human. He did a good job at pretending to be. They could blink, breathe, talk, have sex, do all of the things humans could do. But their blood ran black and hot, almost too hot, like tar. And really, they had more in common with the psychopathic computer from that Stanley Kubrick movie than with people. He stopped advancing on me now and instead spread his arms out wide, turned on his best charming face. I had to give them credit, they really could put on a good smolder, and approached me from a different angle this time. Instead of being annoyed that I'd basically made him look like a fool in front of people, they really hated that. Now, he wanted to make it look like he was an old friend coming in for a hug, something non-threatening, so I'd lower my guard. Fat chance of that. "You know what?" he said, changing his tune. "I'm sorry. How about you give me your name, then I'll give you mine and we can start over." "That sounds like a great idea," I said. "Then I can invite you back to my place and we can drink wine, maybe Netflix and chill. If you're mocking me, I'm going to be very disappointed." All this time, I had been backing away from him, luring him toward the alley I had just come sprinting out of. The last thing I wanted was for anything to happen on the sidewalk, in plain view of the public. Scarce at this hour of the evening, though it may have been. A few paces later, he came close enough for me to let the sword of Damocles, okay, the dagger of Damocles, fall on him, pulling the dagger down from the night sky and sending it hurtling toward him. But the demon had seen the shift in my eyes as the thought formed in my mind, and that was all it needed to be able to glimpse an immediate future where a dagger spilled out of the night and into its brain pan. There was no way he could have moved fast enough to avoid getting hit, but with an almost arrogantly quick tilting of his head to the side, he was spared instant death by a hair's breadth. The dagger connected instead with his shoulder, impaling itself into his collarbone and snapping it in two from the force of the impact. The demon staggered, groaned, and fell against one of the alley walls. A beat passed, then another, and no one screamed, no one cried out. At the edge of the alley, a woman walking alone had her phone pressed to her ear and was asking her boyfriend if he wanted her to bring food home tonight or if they were good. She didn't even glance into the alley, not even to check for potential threats. Not that she'd have seen much anyway, but she may have, if she had been paying attention, seen shifting shadows or heard the crack of bone and the subsequent grunt. I realized why in an instant. Ivy had run across the street and had come within range of us with her magic bubble of invisibility. It wasn't true invisibility. We could still see each other. We cast reflections, shadows. But other people seemed to overlook us as if we weren't actually standing there. Ivy was hiding, though, staying out of sight like I'd asked her to. "You bitch," the demon snarled, his voice deep and hollow. The illusion was broken now, his charm dispelled, like a mask that had turned to ash. Now there was only rage and imminent violence. "You bitch! You bitch! You bitch!" The last colorful word he threw at me carried enough supernatural oomph to crack the windows of the car he'd been leaning against, though not enough to shatter them. I could see him trying to pull the blade out, but failing. Maybe if I wasn't using my invisible hand to keep the knife right where it was. I walked up to him. "I believe the word you're looking for is warlock," I said, staring at him. I hear you've been having your fill around these parts. I hear you've been looking for just the right woman to take home. What's the plan? Possession? Infestation? Impregnation? Fuck you, he spat. How about you tell me where the hellhole you crawled out of is and I'll consider it. Leaving, that is, not letting you fuck me. Or I could kill you right now and no one would hear you scream. I shrugged. Your call. Outside, I was as still as stone, as calm as a mountain. But inside, my brain was working overtime, magic empowering my capacity to think, to process, to perceive. Not even magic could boost my mental capacities to match that of a demon's, but there was something I could do to throw off his ability to see into the future, and that was calculate every possible thing I could do within the next 5 seconds. And in doing so, create the threads to every single one of those futures. The demon's eyes widened as, playing out in front of him, he saw hundreds of potential futures instead of the small handful most people were capable of imagining at the same time. The confusion made him question his next move, and the instant, mere seconds of hesitation were all I needed to pull the knife free of his shoulder with my mind and push it into the side of his skull. He couldn't react fast enough. I watched his eyes bulge from their sockets before immediately turning black. His skin started graying in front of my eyes, the tissue around his lips peeling back to reveal sharpened, crooked yellow teeth. The only similarity between a demon and a brute. This was the demonic equivalent of a bloodhound, only they had less hair, the ability to walk on two legs, and claws so sharp they could shear through slabs of steel like wet paper. Super dangerous, but entirely predictable.
B-b-b,
the demon tried to say. What's that? I asked, making a cup around my ear with my hand. Speak up, Grandpa.
Bitch,
he whispered, before falling limp and collapsing to the floor with a hard thud. Ivy stepped out of the shadows then, walking carefully, giving me and the corpse at my feet a wide enough berth. In the space between us, people continued to walk along the street as if there wasn't a dead monster only a few feet away from them. Humans were easier to fool than demons. I spared only a second or two to catch my breath, heaving deeply. Then I set my backpack down beside the corpse and started pulling things out. First a tube, then a transparent with an unmarked label on it. What's that? Ivy asked. That is how you take down a demon, I said.
No, that's not what I mean.
Oh, this? Glad you asked. Here, hold this. Ivy didn't have a chance to agree or disagree. I had inserted one end of the transparent rubber tube in my hand into one of the bags and had shoved it into her chest. Ivy took it and stared.
Property of St. John's Medical Center? She asked. What is this?
Blood pack.
Why do we need a blood pack?
Actually, we need 8. There's more in the bag.
What? Why?
If you haven't already figured it out, then I'm not going to waste time explaining it to you. I attached a long, thick needle to one end of the tube, then pulled the demon's shirt open and stabbed it through his chest, directly into what passed for the thing's heart.
Holy shit, what are you doing?
I twisted the nozzle on the syringe, allowing a small amount of air to enter the tube and start drawing blood, black and thick, out of the demon, and funnel it into the pack in Ivy's hands. I'm exsanguinating this demon.
You're... what? Why?
When I was happy enough with the flow of blood from corpse to bag, I turned my eyes on Ivy. Look, I'm incredibly grateful that you all took me in. Don't take my not keeping you in the loop about this as a sign of ungratefulness, but the fact is I'm homeless and jobless, and that is the kind of thing that's going to make a girl do desperate things.
Desperate? But isn't this illegal?
I highly doubt your country has laws against removing the blood from a demon's body. For starters, your country doesn't have enough demons in it to even necessitate a law, so tell me why this is illegal. The bag in her hand was filling up, and she was starting to look uncomfortable. Ivy was a smart girl, young and pretty, with smooth, dark skin and cornrows in her black hair. She looked like a punk, with her tattoos and her ripped denim jeans, but blood made her squeamish, and the blood in her hands was still hot.
"We've talked about blood magic before," she said. "I don't know how you or the guy Levi knew got away with it, but it's forbidden here."
"That's funny, considering the practice originated here." She rolled her eyes.
"Whatever, it's still wrong, though."
"It isn't. Demons aren't human, and this isn't blood magic. Not yet, anyway. Will you relax and hand me that bag?" The one in my hands was starting to fill up. Ivy handed the fresh bag over to me, and, like an expert who had done this plenty of times before, I replaced the full bag with an empty one and handed it to her while I stored the full one. The process took a while to complete, and since the demon was dead, I had to use a little apparently forbidden magic to coax it out of his body. But when it was done, I had a backpack thrown over my shoulder with 8 packs of demonic blood sloshing around inside it.
"What do we do about the body?" Ivy asked.
I shrugged. "Give it a few minutes and it'll dissolve."
"Dissolve? Just like that?"
I nodded.
"Oh, that reminds me."
I turned around, knelt beside the body, and checked his pockets. Suit jacket first, then pants. In them, I found a wallet, a set of keys, and a phone. The phone was a burner, so I tossed it in the trash. The keys belonged to a Honda Accord, though where it was, I had no idea. I got rid of those, too. But the wallet. There was some cash in there, some credit cards, and a simple black card with a pentagram on one side of it. I thought the pentagram was silver, but as I moved it around under the light, it changed color like a hologram. I slipped the card back into the wallet and pocketed it.
"My cut?"
Ivy asked, her eyebrow arched. A grin spread across my face.
"Now you're starting to get it," I said.
Then I opened the dead man's wallet and handed her half of the night's takings before pocketing the wallet again.
"Okay, so now what?"
"Now you go back to the apartment while I go and make some arrangements."
"Arrangements?"
"Didn't think I was keeping all this, did you?"
"I don't know. You do blood magic. I don't know how any of that works."
"I'm going to get us a little extra money. Figured we could use it considering the old nerve center was compromised."
"Thanks."
"You're welcome. Now get yourself back to the others and I'll meet you soon. This is my street."
"Can you at least tell me where you're going so we know where to look in case you go missing?"
I shook my head. "Sorry, but we aren't that close yet. I'll be fine. Don't worry."
"And if Levi asks, tell him I went. He can be very persistent, you know. If I don't have a good enough cover story, he'll try and come after you."
I frowned. "I'll give you 5% of what I make from this if you come up with a story he'll swallow." Ivy nodded, grinning.
"We've got a deal."
I watched her take to the street opposite mine and start walking. The underground station wasn't far from where we were now, and I knew she'd be with the others soon. Meanwhile, I headed in the other direction, eyes peeled for signs that anyone other than Ivy and the demon were watching us, feet pounding the pavement. When I was certain the coast was clear, I pulled my phone from my pocket and made the call. It was late over here in London, but it would be early enough in the U.S. There were 2 rings followed by a series of clicks. Then the call connected, like it always did. The line was crackly, delayed by 2 seconds, and a little distorted, but that was only because it was being rerouted to a dozen points around the world before reaching the person I needed to speak to.
"Well, well," the smooth, dark voice on the other line said. "I haven't heard from you in a very long time."
"How did you know it was me?" I asked, flipping my long, red hair across from one shoulder to the other.
"I have my ways."
"Is that supposed to impress me?"
"Come on, princess. You know I'm always looking for ways to impress you."
"All right, well, you can impress me by accepting the offer I'm about to make you."
"I'm listening."
"Is the line secure?" There was a pause then, one filled with crackles and pops that had traveled thousands and thousands of miles through dozens of countries just to reach me.
"I'm putting on my unimpressed face."
"Aw, really? But that's your least attractive face."
"You want to see my attractive face? You got to come out here."
"You got a first-class ticket for me?"
"No."
"What about a portal, then?"
"Shit, you know how expensive those things are." Well, you'd better get one, because I'm walking around the streets of London with 8 pints of demon blood in my backpack and nowhere to go. Think you might know of anyone who'd be interested in such a purchase? Another pause.
Let me get this straight. You're telling me you went looking for a demon, killed it, took its blood, and then went looking for a buyer? You're just as insane as you've always been.
Isn't that why people love me?
It's why I love you.
Oh, bullshit. You say that to all the girls. Now, do you want the blood or not?
Fuck me, you're serious.
No, and yes. But we're burning daylight here, so make with the portal or I find someone else who might have use for this.
Okay, okay.
His voice rose an octave.
Jesus, yes, I'll take it. Tell me where you are, give me an hour to call my portal guy, and I'll give you a spot to get to so we can make the trade.
Make it 30 minutes.
If I get one put together in 30 minutes, you better be ready to jump through it too.
Tempting, but no. I've got my hands full over here. Rain check?
Fine, fine. 1 hour, I'll call you.
Good. I hung up, pocketed the phone, and ducked into the nearest Starbucks I could find, grabbing a latte, a table, and setting the bag between my feet to wait. It took 37 minutes for the call to come through, but when it came, I was ready to go and meet my past for the first time in almost 2 years. Chapter 2. The cold was starting to bite at the tips of my nose and ears when the fabric of space and time ripped apart directly in front of me. It was like watching a piece of cloth fray from the middle outwards, as though being burned by a flame directly behind it. Only the flame was blue and bright, and it filled the space it had created with shifting, shimmering light that almost looked like a pool of water suspended in the air. I watched it as it rippled and moved, saw its glow bounce off the ground at my feet and the underside of the bridge I was standing beneath, listened to it hum. It was like watching the glint of the moon on the water on a cool November night. I rarely got a chance to watch a portal form. They were incredibly expensive to produce because they were incredibly dangerous, and Proximi, the only mages who had the power to create portals and thus the ones in line to get the chop if something were to go wrong with their creation, were the ones who got to set the price tag. But the demon blood in my bag was worth much, much more than what it would cost to hire a mage to open a portal, even on such short notice. My guy had really scrambled to put this together, and had probably only managed it by paying way more than the asking price, so I was impressed. But I would never tell him that. Not in a million years. The portal stabilized, its shimmering surface settling to something that looked like water in zero gravity, a totally smooth, gently pulsing, imperfect circle with frayed edges spilling light in all directions, catching on the frosty grass and flowers below and the underside of a small stone bridge above. A breath passed, and then the portal started to shift, millions if little ripples opening along its surface, disturbing the peace, the smoothness, until slowly, the figure of a man began to emerge from the other side, his dark silhouette contrasting starkly with the brightness of the portal around him. He shuddered when he was through and dusted himself off, the tips of his hands spitting sparkles of light.
"Jesus, I hate those things," he said.
The man that had just crossed an incredible distance in a fraction of a second was taller than me by at least a couple of heads. His chestnut hair, once worn at a moderate length, was now shaved almost to a crew cut, and he had the most infuriatingly adorable dimples on his cheeks I had ever seen. Back in high school, he'd been an athlete. Not the athlete, but an athlete. And that discipline had followed him into adulthood. In fact, he looked even bigger than he had the last time we had seen each other, the black t-shirt he had on clinging tightly to his body, perfectly defining the shape of his chest, his abdomen.
Jesus Christ, he looks good.
I would never tell him that, but damn. You're gonna freeze to death out here in that t-shirt.
Ah, there's my Haley, always looking out for me.
Your Haley? I don't think I was ever your Haley. He tilted his head to the side and narrowed his eyes, still smiling.
Weren't you?
No. I also thought you wanted me to go through to you.
I was 7 minutes past my deadline with the portal, he said,
a sly smirk appearing across his face. Knowing you as well as I do, I knew you wouldn't come through for me, so I figured I'd take matters into my own hands.
You don't know me nearly as well as you think you do.
His grin widened. I can recall receiving plenty of praises for the many, many late nights I spent getting to know you. I rolled my eyes, but couldn't help the smile from forming, or the flush of blood from hitting my cheeks. I'd forgotten how insufferable Mason was, and how good-looking he was, and just how many times, and in how many places, and in how many ways we'd...
All right, I said, snapping myself out of the memories. You're going to have to cut that out right now, or else I'm peddling my wares someplace else.
That would be a decent threat if I thought you knew even a single person who would buy what you've got stashed away in there.
Maybe I do.
Maybe. But I'm a man who trusts his instincts, and my instincts tell me you've been over here keeping your head down like you said you'd be. Otherwise, why would you have called me? If I recall, you were the one who said you didn't want to see me again.
I pointed a finger right at him. Don't, I warned.
He put his hands up.
I'm sorry.
Did that hit a nerve?
Stop being an asshole.
I let the bag slip from my shoulder and fall to the floor. Anyway, I've got it all in here. You've made the wire into the usual account?
You didn't give me any instructions, so no. Didn't think it was still active.
It's active.
Mason produced his phone from his pocket, and I waited while he made a series of quick taps and swipes on the screen.
All right, done,
he said, depositing his phone back into his pocket. After checking my account to verify the transaction and not freaking out over the amount, which was way more than I'd had in my account at any one time in almost 2 years, I kicked the bag over to him. It slid across the frosted ground to where he stood, and he stopped it with his foot. He then picked it up, slung it over his shoulder without checking the contents, and stared at the portal before looking over at me again.
Can I ask you a question?
Oh, God. I hadn't wanted this to go on any longer for exactly this reason. Talking to Mason was not a good idea, not after the way things had ended, and yet I couldn't find a good reason to say no to him, so I didn't.
Yeah, sure.
The grin on his face widened.
You ever think about me?
He asked, flashing a cocky, pearly white smile in my direction. Get lost, Mason, I said, turning around and rolling my eyes for the second, but what felt like the 50th, time tonight. See you in another 2 years.
Want to get a cup of coffee?
I stopped, dead in my tracks, and turned to look at him. What did you just ask me? I asked.
That got your attention, didn't it?
Getting my attention isn't exactly difficult to do. I wouldn't write home about it.
Come get a coffee with me.
I sighed.
Mason.
Haley, it's been 2 years. The least you can do is talk to me.
We did talk. Have talked.
Number one, we didn't talk about it nearly as much as you think. Number two, you left and made it clear you weren't coming back.
Number three, I asked you to come with me, remember?
Okay, that's debatable.
No, it isn't. I told you I was leaving. You knew why. I asked you to come with me.
It's not like you asked me to plan a move. You asked me to go with you tomorrow because that's when your flight was.
So I made a snap decision to ask you to come with me.
What was wrong with that? You didn't give me a chance to react, Haley.
I did. You had a chance to say, sure, I'll come.
But you didn't. And what was I supposed to do? Abandon my life here and move to London with you?
We weren't even exclusive. You made sure I knew that.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.